Welcome to Nightlight. Step away from the mainstream and gather around as we enlighten the world and our realities and travel this cosmic journey we call life. Join us as we share with you and provide that beacon that can guide us all to a better way. Explore with us as we examine a metaphysical montage of spiritual insights, covering everything from the mundane to the magical, UFOs to unicorns, and everything in between. This is a time of awakening, of sharing and evolving, of spreading our wings and soaring on the cosmic breath of creation. Come and join with other light-minded spirits as we weave our lights together to seek understanding, enlightenment, and with a little luck, some wisdom. This is Nightlight, a reminder that you are never alone.
Everybody, I'm really glad you could join me tonight because I have such an exciting show here. I wish I had 5 or 6 hours to talk to this lady, but I don't. But we're going to get as much in as we can. I have Carole Nervig with me, and she's written a book called The Petroglyphs of Mu, Pohnpei, Nan Madol, and the Legacy of Lemuria, all of which topics we could certainly do weeks on. While residing on the small Pacific island of Pohnpei, and she'll pronounce it when I pull her on, but I'm going to stagger through it anyhow, in the 1990s, she discovered that a recent brush fire had exposed hundreds of previously unknown petroglyphs carved on gigantic boulders. This portion of the megalithic site called Pohnpaid was unknown even to the Pohnpei State Historic Preservation Officer. The petroglyphs were unlike any others from Oceania, and she began to investigating and comparing them with petroglyphs and symbols from around the world. She documents her discoveries on Pohnpei, revealing how the archetypal symbols of the Pohnpei petroglyphs had exact counterparts in other ancient cultures and universal motifs throughout the world, including the Australian Aborigines, the Inca in Peru, the Vedic civilization of India, early Norse runes, and Japanese symbols. She provides evidence that Pohnpaid is closely related to and yet predates neighboring Nan Madol, and shows how Pohnpaid was an outpost of the sunken city of the now-vanished civilization of Mu, or Lemuria. She examines how many of the glyphs symbolize celestial phenomena and clearly reveal how the creators were sky watchers with a sophisticated understanding of astronomy, geophysics, geomancy, and engineering. She shows how the scientific concepts depicted in the petroglyphs reveal how the citizens of Mu had a much deeper understanding of the living earth than we do, which gave them the ability to manipulate the natural forces both physically and energetically. Combining archaeological evidence with traditional oral accounts, she reveals Pohnpaid not only as a part of a geodetic network of ancient sacred sites and portals, but also as a remnant of the now submerged but once enlightened motherland of Mu. I have to admit, there was so much in her book that resonates to a lot of the material we've looked at and looked into on this show. So she sort of ties a lot of the stuff together. So we're going to see how much of this she can link in the short time that we have. Welcome to the show, Carole.
Well, thank you, Barbara. I'm very pleased and appreciative to be here. I look forward to our chat. Thank you.
Now that I have butchered how to pronounce the names, the Pohnpei and Pohnpaid, how are they pronounced right?
Well, you know, that's a great place to start. And it is very confusing. In the old days, well, not the old days, some still now pronounce the name of the island as Pohnpei. But that's sort of an English version of, you know, the difference between Milan and Milano. And in Pohnpeian language, the name of their island is Pohnpei. And it's really important because Pohnpei, it literally translates to Pohn is upon, and Pei is a stone altar. So the whole island is a stone altar, according to the inhabitants, the Pohnpeians. So that's one piece of it. And then adding to this confusion is the petroglyph site itself is named Pohnpaid with a D on the end. And so it's very, very similar. So, but there are two. One is the name, Pohnpei is the name of the island, Pohnpaid is the name of the petroglyph site. And then sometimes people confuse it even with Pohnpei in Italy, which of course has nothing to do with it. But
yeah. Now, you fell in love with this area when you were in the Peace Corps, or is that how you got your juices flowing with this particular area of the world?
Exactly. Our group went to Pohnpei in 1969, and we had 6 weeks of training. Back then, there wasn't a road around the island, and so our training site, we actually went by a steamer for 2.5 days, so, and got off into outriggers. Anyway, that's how it began. So we had 6 weeks of cultural and language training at this particular village. And then our reward for completing it, they organized some outboard boats and motors, and we were to go on a trip to Nan Madol. And so none of us really knew what Nan Madol was or what the big deal was. And we had to leave in the middle, you know, before the sun rose, because the only way to get through the reef there is during high tide. So we made the whole trip in the dark, and then we climbed out of the boat in the dark and got to the main area there. And when the sun came up, we were surrounded by these amazing 40-foot basalt walls, and it was just, that's when it began. That's when my obsession, because I was, as I mentioned in the book, it was, you know, I was just amazed. But on the other hand, I was emotional. I was angry. It's like, why doesn't the world know about this place? This is comparable to all these major sites, and no one's even heard of it. So that became my job, I guess, to start telling the story of these sites on Pohnpei Island.
Well, I think also that and I didn't mention, but I should have, that you created the Nan Madol Foundation as well. And Nan Madol is yes, it's an amazing site that is not understood and misinterpreted like crazy, but in you know, what is your explanation of why Nan Madol was created?
Well, that's a large question, and however, there is an answer in the Pohnpeian oral history, and the petroglyph site that my book is about is part of the answer to that, I believe, because I believe the petroglyph site is older than Nan Madol. Uh-huh. And the oral histories talk about these brothers that they were circling the island looking for a place to build their administrative center, their religious center. And they started in a few other places. And then when they finally got in the vicinity of where Nan Madol is, there's a large bay there, and they climbed this pyramidal shaped mountain and looked down, and they saw the city of the ancients under the water. So that is why Nan Madol was built where it was. And the petroglyph site, in my opinion, also confirms this for several reasons, but it was built to honor the sunken city under the water, which of course has not been found. And hopefully all I need is a submarine. But so
I'd be able to help you with that.
Yeah. Well, so it's the same old situation, site upon a site. And, you know, many sites, sacred sites around the world are originally pagan or whatever, and then usurped by churches and religion and so on and so forth. Mm-hmm. But I believe that the petroglyph site, which is all the elements of a major sacred site on its own and aside from Nan Madol, is either another remnant of that city under the water. But, you know, if the waters rose, often cultures have their sacred places on mountaintops. And so where the petroglyph site is, you know, at the time when the city actually is given a name by oral history, Kahnihmueiso, and so it could have been a mountaintop, a sacred area for shamanic journeying, for their whatever spiritual ceremonies and beliefs and so on and so forth. So it could have been that, and also, or it could have been created in the same principle as Nan Madol, to honor what's under the water, because all three sites, the petroglyph site, Nan Madol, and what's under the water, that location there, I mean, it's all very within miles of each other. And it's, I mean, the reason it's all there, the base reason, in my opinion, is it's a portal. It's an interdimensional portal, or many cultures call them navels, and they're found all around the world. And the major sites, I mean, there are a system of these.
Well, I think what I found was, you know, Nan Madol has gotten a really bad reputation. And, you know, it's so often spoken of as being someplace that's cursed and it's evil and it's all sorts of stuff. And it makes greater sense that it is set there to mark where the city of light, you know, went down, and it's right there. And I think that in seeing how overgrown Nan Madol is, and certainly the Pohnpei is also overgrown, I think what people don't understand is that there truly are places in this world that are so overgrown that the signs of antiquity are just not there anymore. And the story of how you discovered the petroglyphs is a fascinating one, because they've just been laying there waiting, and you were going to show a friend of yours a couple of boulders that were there that were goddess related, and you tell a story. It's a very cool story.
Well, it was pretty much a life life-changing experience in many ways. I mean, I was already hooked on Nan Madol, but this was, yes, there. I mean, there are two, the Petroglyph site has sort of two components. One is this huge, enormous, solid rock outcrop, and it's covered with petroglyphs. And at the time, everybody, you know, everybody knew about that, and people would go see them, and I'd been there many, many, many times, and I wasn't even thrilled about taking my friend out there because it's hot and it's miserable. So I talked him into an air-conditioned car rental. I said, if you get an air-conditioned car, I'll go. And those that know me know I don't do well with heat and humidity. So when we got there, though, the second part of the site is a meadow, somewhat, well, at the time it was burned off because Pohnpei gets about 400 and some inches of rain a year in the center of the island. And so it's always rainforest jungle, and you never, I mean, everything's always overgrown. So there had been a drought. And for fun, you know, the kids had, you know, matches, and they saw that it burned. So they just burned this whole field off just, you know, because they could. Anyway, so we walked up the path and looked over, and here's this meadow with nothing. I mean, it was all burnt, and we saw these large stones. And so, of course, we headed directly over there. And when we got to the first one, which was enormous, and we got up close, and it was covered with petroglyphs. And these are not, and it was, there were many of them, not just one megalith, huge boulder. They were strewn over this whole meadow, and I was in complete shock and was just kind of wandering around. I mean, he had the presence of mind to take a lot of photographs. I took a few, and I there are who knows how many more are there, undiscovered, because number one, they could be on the bottom sides of these stones. And the smaller stones, and how many more? I mean, we did not thoroughly cover the whole site, but it was when that happened, it was so it did get my attention. I mean, how often is there a drought?
Well, yeah, that's what I was going to say. Has the site now become overgrown again?
Well, unfortunately, it has. I mean, there have been, while I was there doing the nonprofit for Nan Madol, that was during the time when I came across the petroglyph field. And so I tried to get, you know, some grants and get, well, it was still relatively not overgrown. And I wasn't able to do that, and mostly because nobody knew they were there. And excuse me. That was in, when did I leave? Like 1993. And so after I left Pohnpei and started working on my books, I realized I really wanted to have more photographs of the petroglyphs. And so in 2018, I did a GoFundMe trip back to Pohnpei for the purpose of shooting more photos. But when I got there, my Pohnpeian family took me out to the site, and it was totally overgrown, and it was, they weren't too excited about traipsing through the jungle there. But and I only managed to find one of probably the largest boulder, and it was completely overgrown with trees and roots. And the smaller boulders, no idea where they were. And it was, you know, I was there for a month, but trying to get the government to get funding and get a crew, you know, needed at least a dozen men and machetes. And so nothing moves that quickly on the, in the island.
No.
So that was disappointing.
But you said that it appeared that there was even a stone circle there, but it wasn't exact. It looked like it had been moved around a little bit. But that would make sense, too. And is there, I know originally the site was considered to be goddess-oriented because there was a penis stone and there was a vagina stone there. And wasn't that what you were taking your friend to see at first?
Well, it's confusing because there are there was one well-known Takayanpasu, which translates to clam stone. And in Pohnpei uh-huh. language, clam is slang for vagina. So it's kind of fun. Anyway, so we were headed there because that's where the fork in the road turns to the big petroglyph outpost. When we got to that first and well-known already vagina stone, that's when we saw the cleared meadow. And we headed out there and found at that time another enormous vagina stone. And then the only new discovery on my 2018 trip back was right by the road. It was a smaller, I got to looking at it. It was this literally stone shaped like a clam, and the petroglyph was the scallops on the side of the clam. So
wow.
I did get a picture of that. So the vagina stone and this huge monolith phallic stone that is currently on its side, whether it ever stood up or whether it was really that, I mean, the concept of Pohnpei being a fertility site is mine. Nobody has seen any of this or, you know, connected the dots with this site. And the uh-huh. reason, the oral history, there are different versions of legends about how those vagina stones were originally women or goddesses that came from the sky and came there, and they were, you know, they were dismembered by a magician, or they were one way or another cut up into form these vagina stones, and there was no oral history about the phallic stone whatsoever. And the well-known vagina stone that everybody already knew about, the legend surrounding that is if you touch it, you get pregnant. So that's certainly a fertility aspect. And the, well, it didn't work. I don't know. It didn't work for me. Thank God. But
you have pictures of all of these glyphs. What do they suggest? Glyphs tell a story. What kind of a message were the glyphs giving?
Well, as far as the oral history goes, there's nothing. Even the family okay. that lived on the land that knew there were stones with writing on them, they have no idea who made them. And so, and there's no oral history about the glyphs and their meaning, nor the purpose of the site. So that's why I feel it's much older, and older than Nan Madol, because there are many, many oral histories and stories, very detailed, surrounding Nan Madol. But uh-huh. so the main legend about this Pohnpei petroglyph site is that two brothers from a different district on the island, they stole a blanket, and they came to the Pohnpei site. Some, you know, all these legends have a lot of variations. They flew, or they came, or whatever. They came on their stone canoe, or whatever. And they threw the blanket down on the earth, and because they didn't want to get caught or something. And so after they did that, there was a doorway. They put the blanket on top of this huge outcrop, and there was a doorway in the outcrop. And they exited. They left through that doorway never to come back. So that a blanket could symbolize writing in a way. Uh-huh. I mean, you know, in these early on in these, they didn't have words for any kind of technologies that might be advanced or whatever. So they went through, this is what I considered a portal site.
Mm-hmm. Well, you said you also were showing how a lot of the symbols were very, very similar to those in many other cultures. And, you know, when we're talking about age-wise, I mean, about what time frame do you put Lemuria and Atlantis and certainly this site? How old would you say they are? Guessing wise, I know nothing.
The question I always dread, but I mean, well, first of all, I'm in general, Mu or Lemuria is older than Atlantis, and as those continents, the land masses sank in the Pacific. Some before it sank, there were those that they already established colonies of higher civilization elsewhere around the world. And then, of course, during its demise and after, there were survivors that came. And one of and Atlantis, I mean, maybe not all of the beings there, but they were, you know, from Mu, and they established it originally, and then other influences later. And of course, the time, you know, it's just very, very complicated. And as far as, you know, my niche is the petroglyph site, and petroglyphs are, of course, also impossible to date. So,
yeah.
Anyway, I'm assuming that petroglyph site was, it could have been after, you know, the major cataclysms and floods around, you know, between 10,000 and 12,000 BC. So it's, I would, you know, perhaps the youngest that petroglyph site might be a few thousand years less than that, you know, 6,000, 7,000, 8,000 BC. And, you know, as you know, they're Göbekli Tepe and other sites. I mean, they're in Yanaguni and off the coast of Japan. They're all dated, before that time of the 12,000 or 11,900
years. Yeah, I am not an archaeologist and don't claim to be one. However, I have some talents and skills in other directions, and my feeling is that Atlantis, Lemuria, probably Nan Madol, and certainly this site predate the cataclysm, so that they've truly been lost in time, and you know, there was an ice age, and then there was a flood, and there was all sorts of stuff, and and you know, rocks seem to survive just about anything, and you know, they do, and so I would bet money that when the plates shifted, when the poles shifted, that this particular part of the Earth plate never froze or anything, so it was always, you know, it was always in full growth and stuff like that. But of course, the populace was gone because of the cataclysms, and you know, it just sort of sat there waiting. And you know, there are crosses with 1, 2, and 3 circles around them there that you see in lots of places. There, you know, your book has wonderful examples of different pictographs, petroglyphs, that really are similar in with all cultures all around the world. And it's sort of like what what it is to me fascinating is that petroglyphs, they don't stand for a word, they stand for a concept, and it's very much like hieroglyphs. And depending on the level of consciousness of the person doing the interpretation, it that then determines what that feeling is that is being expressed. So,
exactly. So
I kind of figure you discovered something, and you probably have the ability at some point in time to get your consciousness to the point where you can get the feeling for the point of the message. You know, clearly they were leaving a message of some sort. It's sort of like I often wonder, how do we leave a message for 10,000, 12,000 years from now? And, you know, it's, you know, the written word and a computer disk and all of that is not going to float it. It's got to be something that sends a message that is undeniable, and you have to hope that the consciousness of the people trying to understand it is in the right place to understand it. And that's probably what's happening here, and the same thing with Egypt and in a lot of other places. You know, the archaeologists have the intellect to decipher the symbol and what they think it means, but not the level of consciousness to actually pull the meaning from the picture. That's just me.
Exactly. Right.
But
well,
and I.
Go ahead.
No, I loved, you know, you have wonderful graphs, you have wonderful pictures of the continents, and when both Lemuria and Atlantis were both above water, it's very clear how there easily could have been migration from continent to continent to continent. I mean, there's just no doubt. And
the Pacific navigators, you know, they've done that in more recent times and traveled even further distances in their outriggers. So, yes.
Yeah.
One thing about the petroglyphs, and, you know, and again, a petroglyph site is often, I mean, rituals go on there. And Pohnpaid is no different, located on a telluric grid line, and there's archaeo-astronomical components, but the petroglyphs themselves often, you know, again, like site upon site, there are layers of petroglyphs upon layers, and some, I have no doubt, are more mundane and some more esoteric. And back in the time of Mu, they didn't really have a language, and so the very first written symbols, they were symbols and petroglyphs, and they were to be felt with your hands. I mean, you would feel and hear them. And so, again, that civilization was a lot more highly evolved and could do these kinds of things. But, and then slowly, as, you know, they became more embodied in the physical and language developed and so forth. But yes, that the symbols were, well, the megalithic libraries, what I like to call them. And and one thing about the dating, I Nan Madol is quite much more recent. The very the conventional dates 900 AD and to 1600 AD is where the huge structures were built. However, the archaeologists have found material evidence from 0 to 200 AD. So, and there were also, and people don't really talk about this much, most of the, you know, the program that you see about Nan Madol, but there were people already living on Nan Madol before these brothers came and started these huge structures. And they were considered by some to be the first engineers of the site. So it's all very complicated in dating, and the Atlantis and Mu, the civil Lemuria Mu, I mean, who knows how far that went way back. And you know, that at this point there's not really any way of dating that. Plus, you know, now we're on this linear time-space paradigm, and at that, you know, if you go back far, time might not have been linear. So there's all that to consider.
Well, I was so delighted when suddenly I saw you bringing giants and little people into it too. That to me, I believe in both of them, and yet try to get archaeologists to say, yeah, they existed. But tell the story about how you had guides that were actually little people.
Right. Well, of course, archaeologists, they have to be careful because, you know, they survive on grants and funding and, you know, and at least publicly. But, I was back when I, in the 90s, after the Peace Corps, I left, and then midlife crisis came back in the 90s to do the nonprofit for Nan Madol. And when I was there, I kept having this dream, and the dream was saying, go to Takayu. You have to go to Takayu. You have to climb Takayu. Well, Takayu is that pyramid mountain that in the legends that the brothers, they climbed and they saw Nan Madol. They saw the city of the ancients, Kahnihmueiso, under the water. Okay, so I borrowed a truck, I guess, and drove out. I knew the general vicinity, and I, you know, finally got on the right road and drove out to the area. I mean, road, using the term loosely. Anyway, I was questioning my sanity, and then finally I came across this house. So I got out and started talking to them. I was, you know, where's the path to climb Takayu? And they said, well, you know, it's you can access it from our property. And the guy said, I'll send my two sons with you to help you find it. And I thought, oh, great. And, you know, there were these two little kids, and I figured, you know, well, no way I could have found it by myself. Anyway, so we walked through the mangroves, and that was always interesting. And we started climbing, and it's a pyramidal-shaped peak, and it's really steep. And it's deceiving. It didn't look all that big, but we got about halfway up, and, you know, I had them going ahead of me because I had a skirt. I mean, you had to wear skirts, and I had on flip-flops and a skirt, you know. So
great mountain climbing. Yeah.
And I was actually much younger at the time, but finally, we were about two-thirds of the way up, and I said, look, I don't know if I can go any further. So we sat down and started talking, and I said, well, so what grade are you guys in? And, you know, I thought they were maybe, you know, maybe 10, 12, 14, something like that. And they said, well, no, we're out of school. And I said, what? And one was 20, early 20s, and the other one was 17 or something like that. I'm going, oh, my God, here I'm out here. This is not proper island behavior. And so, you know, I was just blown away because they were short. I mean, they were little. And so I asked them, I said, well, are you guys some of the little people? And they said, yeah, it's our family. We're the guardians of this pyramidal peak. And our ancestors were here, you know, when the legend of the stones falling from the sky and making this pyramidal mountain, there was a battle in the sky or a battle between magicians or various versions. So that was my actual experience of meeting some little people on Pohnpei. Not too many. I mean, in general, they're shorter. I did not meet any giants, however. I mean, who knows what's in the jungles, but the oral history is very clear that they have names for the little people and the giants, and it's just kind of accepted.
It's fascinating that they have survived that long as little people and not, you know, intermingled and mixed their genetics and stuff like that. But I think you said someplace in the book that in the 80s they were still in the census as a tribe.
Well, that, yes, but that was Hawaii. The little people in Hawaii, they're known as Menahune, or they're also known as the Mu. I mean, the Pacific Islanders, they don't have a problem accepting Mu. And it was the, 1800s, mid to late 1800s. Oh, I'm so bad at dates. And they had Menahunes listed on Hawaii, the official U.S., not U.S., but the official Hawaii census.
Huh.
So there's actual legal documentation of them in Hawaii.
Well, and, you know, so many people say, nah, there were never any little people. And I know Mary Joyce has met people that have met little people that were very little people. So they're still around. And obviously the giants are a lot harder to hide, but they definitely, there are, I guess, throwbacks or fallbacks or whatever genetically, and there are some people that are quite tall, but and they don't have giantism, you know, that they are just naturally very, very tall. So and I think that what you are pulling up and you know, putting into the public eye is the fact that this part of the country and certainly Micronesia, there's magic still there, and the Lemuria is close by Nan Madol, makes it even, you know, more magical that there could be the ruins of an amazing city underwater there, but I guess it's very deep there, so you can't. I know you mentioned that you had done diving, but it's deeper than you can go. Is that basically it?
Well, yes, I did a lot of scuba diving there and had some interesting experiences with that. But the Kahnihmueiso, I believe it's way, you know, it's really, really deep. And because it's outside the reef, I don't believe it's in the big bay there right next to Nan Madol. There may be entries there. And I did find, I was swimming with my ex-English student from the, well, I was in the Peace Corps. He was, in the 90s, he was the official in the Historic Preservation Office. And so we were scuba diving one time, and we were at Nan Madol, and the weird thing when you, everywhere else in the island, the water is clear, crystal clear, pristine, you know, world-class scuba diving. But right around Nan Madol, it's murky. You can't see barely 5 feet ahead of you. And anyway, so we were, Nan Madol sits at the edge of the reef, so we were scuba diving along the reef looking for whatever, and we came to this kind of a natural opening. It looked like kind of a natural cave-like thing, and of course, we only had one flashlight. I had the flashlight, so we swam in there. It wasn't all that far, and then I just thought, oh, well, this is, and then we went to the back wall, and there was a man-made tunnel. There were three.
Oh,
there was
wow.
One 2D side, and they were made of columnar basalt, and of course, unfortunately, they're only like 2 feet by 2 feet, so with scuba tanks, you couldn't get, you know, we couldn't go in, and then before I knew it, he left. He went up to the, and I'm going, what the hell, and of course, I had to go with him, you know, scuba diving. I had to stay with my buddy. He didn't. I followed him up. And I said, why did you leave? And it was, I think he was kind of embarrassed because He was afraid. He was not afraid. He was freaked out. And he had a, you know, he had a college degree. It wasn't like he was some, you know, what's the word? Well, anyway.
He wasn't a neophyte, yeah.
No, superstitious is the word that I was, I mean, he wasn't.
Oh, okay.
Anyway, but, like you say, Nan Madol has sort of a bad reputation because, you know, the Peace Corps, I mean, nobody went there. The locals were afraid to go there. And so because of the spirits and the, so, I mean, that's changed over the years, but there's still a lot of reluctance. And there is one account, Masao Hadley told me, and he's the Pohnpeian elder informer that, you know, was crucial in sharing all this information. Anyway, he told that there was, that, you know, they go diving and turtle hunting, right? Spearing turtles. And so there were some fishermen, and they were, well, turtles or whatever they were, but the one guy speared this turtle, and the turtle took him way, way down deep, you know, outside the reef, and he came back, both came back with stories of this amazing city under the water, and with streets and so on and so forth. And because they came up too fast or what, they both died. So that was it. And so, you know, is this true? I mean, who knows? But Masao is, you know, the most respected expert on Nan Madol. So,
well, you know,
your
book, I mean, it covers so much material that it's phenomenal. And the linking of the petroglyphs across cultures does suggest that there was a single source for all of humanity, and you know, you certainly are suggesting that it was Lemuria, and it makes perfect sense. What is your hope for what the book can do for bringing all of this sort of into the public eye, so that more investigation is done?
Well, first of all, at, you know, the more mundane level, I mean, to share these petroglyphs, because professionals, archaeologists that see these petroglyphs, they will get that this is something worth taking a second look at or a deeper look at. All of these, because they're not like, you know, the Hawaiian petroglyphs are very elegant. They're more like stick figures. These are some of them very sophisticated, and I believe, especially astronomically. And so my hope for this book will generate interest and funding to get some professionals out there, to get LIDAR, to get new technologies at the petroglyph site, because who knows what's underneath, and who knows what configurations these megaliths might be in. That is, I mean, that was my motivation, because both the historic preservation and the, I mean, there's no one on Pohnpei that's ever seen these. They've all passed away. There was another archaeologist there, and I took him to the site, and he's no longer with us. So I didn't, there was nobody else that could do this. So it was like, and I just didn't, I wanted to share all this before I'm still around. And so that's the first goal. And the second, you know, acknowledging Pohnpaid as a goddess site and what that entails, and being part of a system of sacred sites, of a grid around the planet, that these ancients were so connected to nature, a part of nature, and they built these pyramids and these sites because they understood the earth energies. And I think it had a lot to do with creating balance on the earth, whether it's weather or harmony or stabilization. And, you know, as we are just going hell-bent to destroy our planet these days, there is so much to learn from looking at these sites with more evidence connecting more of the dots. Why did they do this? And what, you know, there have been lots of studies on the pyramids and the water and electricity and what the, you know, that's, this is all part of that system. So I would hope both of those things might happen. And, you know, the big picture, this was a goddess site. This was that back then when they understood the planet, there was balance between the masculine and the feminine. And, you know, we've certainly got off the rails there. So I guess that would be my third outcome to not domination by either one, but balance.
Well, I think the fact that if you go way back in time, I mean, you mentioned Laird Scranton, and he's been on the show a number of times, and his Maori what I find fascinating is when you get way back in antiquity, it's not really a religion, but it's a spiritual practice. And it's a spiritual belief system. It's not worshiping anything. It's having reverence for something, and there's a difference. And I think that you know what you've got going here, especially taking it back to I love you know you called it you know the mother of all of humanity, and I think the motherland, and it makes great sense. And I think, you know, people have more or less, you know, admitted, you know, Atlantis existed. They're not sure exactly where, but it existed. And I think that, you know, you're right on the precipice of getting them to accept the fact that so did Lemuria. And I would love to see people looking, you know, with submarines out there trying to find the city that is submerged there. And, I mean, after the Japanese found the site that they did, it should be very, very clear that there are other sites that have gone underwater. And especially, you know, probably it was a comet hit that melted a lot of the polar stuff, and it flooded everything. And so it makes great sense to be looking for Lemuria as well. I mean, at first, Lemuria and Atlantis were both myths, and now they say, well, Atlantis did exist. They're just not exactly sure where. And you know, we're coming to a time where, you know, hopefully they will admit that Lemuria existed too. And certainly your petroglyph site is a really good hint that there is something more profound there, because you don't just find these sites just standing out there all by themselves. There's usually a lot more there, and you know, look at Göbekli Tepe. They haven't even started to uncover all that's there, and there are other places where, you know, in Africa there are circles, and they're finding more in England with LIDAR, so that there's so much going on with new discoveries. It would be great to have somebody take LIDAR over the whole island to discover what else is there too. How big an island is it?
Well, Pohnpei is a little bit smaller than the Hawaiian island of Kauai, so I think it's about 60 miles in circumference. It's not, you know, it's not that large. So yes, they did do one LIDAR study of the island adjacent to Nan Madol, and they found terracing there, and that was really exciting. And but the petroglyphs, I mean, that would be the easiest. I mean, relatively, I mean, you wouldn't have to clear the jungle. So I'm hoping that, you know, that's actually feasible, but there needs to be, you know, an archaeologist that can get funding and organize, do this professionally. I mean, there's not really anyone on the island that can do this sort of thing. So,
it's probably why it survived. You know, I mean,
yeah. Yes. And the thing is, Pohnpei being a fertility site, I mean, more than fertility, I mean, the whole, what you mentioned about, you know, the pagan or the ancient, the motherland, it was, not a religion as we know it today, but it was, they were just, nature was their religion. They were one and the same. And that continues with indigenous people around the world still. And so we need to, I think, pay attention to that.
Well, I agree with you because certainly certainly the earth energy is something that people are not paying attention to. People are just now rediscovering that earthing is something that helps to balance out your whole system. Walking barefoot on the earth, you know, puts you in touch with the earth heart, the heartbeat of the earth, and that helps you to be healthier. I mean, it's very clear,
exactly.
And they've got so it's a matter of, come on, let's look and see what else is out there. I think people are so blown away with, you know, the big stuff. They're not paying any attention to stone circles like you've got, or stone chambers like Patrick and I found, or any of the stone edifices that are out there that are signals that there was a culture here and there was a reason for it, and pay attention to it. So your book is beautifully done. The pictures are phenomenal, and the charts you have in there showing, you know, the different land masses and how they probably were, does lead one to believe that, you know, yes, Lemuria has to be as real as Atlantis was, and again, it's probably going to be a while before it's actually found, but once it's found, it will be so enlightening because that may bring people's awareness back to the, you know, what was the culture like, what were they involved in, and that opens the door to having people understand that being a part and attached to the earth is far more important than the stars, to be honest with you.
Exactly. I agree.
It's closer to home, too.
Yeah, for sure.
But well, I would.
Everything is, like you say, everything. There are so many discoveries on all the continents going back, older and older sites. So it's just, this is the time where things are being exposed and more things accepted. So it's very exciting.
Well, and in a way you were chosen too. So I think, you know, you can't belittle that, but I would imagine this book is only the beginning of, you know, a lot of stuff that you're going to have to be, you will be drawn into in spite of yourself. So going to be a fun trip for you, for sure. I just noticed our time is up, but I do want to thank you so much for taking the time to spend with me and my audience, and I, you know, your book is phenomenal. I noticed that you had a website that wasn't up yet when I got my guest form. Is your website up now?
No, I'm afraid not. I'm not my next goal. My next book is focusing just on Nan Madol, so I'm not sure when that's going to happen. I do have a Facebook page with the title of the book, but I haven't finished my second book, and then I will turn my energy towards that.
Well, I want to thank you so much. This has been so fascinating. Can't wait for Nan Madol. That would be a fun one. It happens to be something I'm intrigued by. But I thank you so much for being here tonight and so much for sharing your time with us.
Well, thank you, Barbara. It was an honor and a privilege to talk to you. I'm always, my favorite topic, of course.
Yeah, stones. Mine too.
Right.
Mine too. So thank you again, and I will make sure that when your next book comes out, I will get you back, and I'll pump you for more information.
I look forward to it.
Take care now, and good night.
Good night.
Thank you, everybody, for being here. Do check in with us tomorrow night. Mark has a fascinating show, and then later in the week, I have Susan Chomsky coming on. So again, it's a full week for us, but do take some time to share your time with us, because we have some amazing people that are we're stumbling over them, and we're trying so hard to get everybody on because they're all so fascinating. Have a great evening, everybody. Take care now.